congratulations on your nomination and welcome to you and your family on your second Senate confirmation hearing. So this committee considers your nomination after nearly a year and a half of reckoning with President Trump's erratic approach to foreign policy, which has left our allies confused and our adversaries emboldened. It's an approach driven by impulse, not strategy. President Trump's America First policies have left America isolated and alone in the midst of unprecedented challenges. Challenges from an aggressive Russia who seeks to undermine the international order we helped create after World War II that has brought peace and stability to the world for nearly three quarters of a century. A destabilized Middle East, the ongoing threat of terrorism, an emboldened China asserting itself in the South China Sea militarily and economically right here in the Western Hemisphere. Assad, a butcher who has used chemical weapons against innocent civilians. Maduro tightening his grip on his regime, starving Venezuelans in one of the most oil-rich countries in the world. Meanwhile, President Trump has abandoned the very democratic values and ideals that have shaped America's role as a beacon to our friends and as a bulwark against a world in crisis. Now, I was pleased to hear you say earlier this week that you plan to support the career public servants at the State Department. The problem is we have an emaciated State Department under this administration. Let me be clear. Members of this committee expect every Secretary of State to champion the department and its mission. We expect you to advocate for robust diplomacy as the first line of defense against sending our sons and daughters into war. And to do that, we need a strong diplomatic corps and an AID that complements and enhances our foreign policy. Now, as CIA director, your job was to conduct covert operations and collect, evaluate, and provide intelligence to policymakers, including the president. As the Secretary of State, you will not be provided intelligence for other people to use to make policy. You will be the person executing the foreign policy of the United States of America. Many countries in the world already think the State Department's an extension of the CIA. So how you conduct yourself moving forward will be critical to our diplomacy. As the Senate considers your nomination to be the president's top foreign policy advisor, we must ask, will you enable President Trump's worst instincts? Will you advocate for long-term strategies to protect U.S. national security and interests, or will you be lurching from crisis to crisis as we've seen under this administration? Will you advocate for robust diplomacy, or will you take America into unnecessary and costly wars? Will you stand up to President Trump and say, no, you're wrong in that view, Mr. President, or will you be a yes man? Americans are scared that this president, the commander in chaos, will lead them into war. This is not a time for taunts and tweets. On Russia, the intelligence community and our military leaders have repeatedly stated that Russia poses ongoing threats to United States national security and to our allies. Yet President Trump cannot bring himself to even acknowledge the Russian threat. He says that a court-granted search warrant is an attack on our country, but cannot call out Russian cyber attacks on our democracy. Will you push the president to put together a real strategy to counter Russian aggression? Will you urge the president to implement the mandatory sanctions that Congress overwhelmingly passed and he has failed to implement? North Korea poses a real and nuclear threat to the United States, our citizens, and our allies. The American people are deeply worried by an erratic president who uses schoolboy taunts when talking about nuclear war. A meeting is not a strategy. Preventing nuclear war requires thoughtful diplomacy, preparation, clear objectives. Will you enable the voices around the president seeking to go to war, or will you press for an empowered diplomatic path to protect the safety of all Americans? Mr. Director, what is your actual plan to stop North Korea from getting a nuclear weapon? Turning to Iran, everyone knows I voted against the Iran nuclear deal and was vociferous about it. But I also share the assessment of your counterparts across national security agencies that it does not serve the United States national security interest to unilaterally withdraw from the deal, absent a strategy for what will replace it, and how to get our allies to join us in countering Iran's malign activity outside of the nuclear program and deal with the sunset issues within the nuclear portfolio. Once again, this president is hurling towards a crisis. He is creating unnecessary risk with the very allies we need to confront Iran. So I ask again, Mr. Director, what's your plan? Will you be a voice of reason, or will you support the president's worst instincts? If confirmed as the Secretary of State, you will no longer be operating in the shadows of American foreign policy. You will be the face and voice of the United States, the representatives not just of a bombastic president, but of the American people. Will you champion our values? When the president embraces dictators who quash the free press or suggest doing away with elections, will you stay silent? When the president and those closest to him balk at the very idea of diplomacy and instead advocate unnecessary wars that will cost the blood of our children and the treasure of our coffers, will you go along with them? Or as our nation's top diplomat, will you champion diplomacy and offer actual plans? Will you stand up to President Trump and advise him differently when he's wrong? Or will you be a yes man? So, Mr. Director, I look forward to hearing your testimony, the answer to these questions and others as we move forward.
Thank you, sir. Director, you've been well background with the three senators who came before us, so I will not do that, but we thank you for being here. If you could summarize your testimony in about 5 minutes or so, any written documents you have, we'll be glad to enter into the record. But with that, thank you for being here. We look forward to your comments.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm not sure I can do it in 5 minutes, but I'll give it my level best.
We always try to set a high bar, realizing we're never going to achieve it.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Chairman Corker, Ranking Member Menendez. Thank you. Thanks for the opportunity to appear here today as the nominee to be the United States Secretary of State. I am grateful to each of you for the attention that you have given us over the past weeks. So many of you have given so much time, and there are so many global matters before us. I'm deeply appreciative of that. Should I be confirmed, this regular contact will continue. You can talk to Senator Burr. I worked at that diligently. As a former member of Congress, I understand the importance of that continued relationship and advice that comes from outside of the executive branch. I'd like to take a moment here, too, to thank Secretary Tillerson for his service to the United States and his commitment to the smooth transition. And I'd like to thank Secretary Sullivan as well for him serving in the gap. A personal thank you also to every living former Secretary of State. They each took my call. They found time to spend with them. I've actually talked to many of them multiple times. Democrats and Republicans, from Secretary Kissinger to Secretary Kerry, were kind enough to visit me and share with me their thoughts on how, if I'm confirmed, I would be most likely to be a successful Secretary of State. And if you know me at all, the two people sitting to my right rear provide my ballast, my balance. Susan keeps the home front humming. It's always there to remind me of family issues that affect not just the Pompeos, but family issues that affect every officer at the Central Intelligence Agency as well. And Nick keeps me humble, keeps my sense of humor alive. Since I've left the private sector and entered public service, they've had lots of opportunities to tell me to step back, to step away, but they haven't. They've encouraged it, they've promoted it, and they are incredibly supportive of my efforts to serve America. A moment here, too, to the men and women of the CIA, to say that it's been an honor and privilege and a joy doesn't do justice to these past 15 months. I've demanded an awful lot of you. I've set the expectation bar high. I've pushed responsibility and authority down to each and every one of you, and along with that, the required accountability. And you, the warriors of the CIA, have delivered for America, for President Trump, and for me. Perhaps the highest compliments of our work come from our adversaries, who fear and are in awe of the institution, and from our partner services around the world, who has asked for more training, more intelligence, more joint operations than ever. To you, if I'm confirmed, this won't be goodbye, because no matter how this nomination process ends, I will be with you, I will support you, and I will admire you. And finally, I want to thank the President for his confidence and trust in me. My job at the CIA has been to deliver world-class intelligence, data, and facts to help inform he and the other senior policymakers in America. I'm honored that he selected me to help carry out many of those same decisions as his chief diplomat. Senators, if I'm confirmed, I will raise my hand and swear an oath to defend our Constitution for the seventh time in my life. The first time I was 18 years old, a West Point cadet. With this oath, I'll swear to defend the exceptionalism enshrined in our Constitution, which provides for our obligation to engage in diplomacy and model the very best of America to the world. Make no mistake, America is uniquely blessed, and with those blessings comes a duty to lead. As I have argued throughout my time in public service, if we do not lead for democracy, for prosperity, and for human rights around the world, who will? No other nation is so equipped with the same blend of power and principle. Two things I want to try and answer for you in the time I have remaining. Who is Mike Pompeo, and what are his thoughts and plans to lead our State Department? I'm sure we'll get to talk about that some more as well. Born in Orange, California. Well, we didn't have a whole lot of money in my family, but I enjoyed school, and my brother and sister and I, we all had fun learning. When I was a teenager, I was an employee of the month at Baskin-Robbins, not once, but twice. I'm a movie buff. I have a soft spot for my golden retrievers. I love meatballs that I make with my dad's recipe, and I enjoyed being a fifth-grade Sunday school teacher for kids that just didn't want to sit still. And although he'll dispute this, I can beat my son in cornhole every day. I love Revolutionary War history, country music, show tunes, and college basketball. But it was my appointment at the United States Military Academy that changed my life. It was when I traveled there, it was the first time I'd ever been east of the Mississippi River. I've seen some describe my leadership style as blue collar. Fair enough. I am not afraid to get my hands dirty, and you will seldom find me ensconced on the senior level of any building. I have no discomfort with directness or confrontation. I prefer face-to-face as opposed to email. I don't hold grudges. I work towards a mission, and I'll always make room for student programs and youth groups. They are what will set our nation on its correct course. They're our future. Just this past Monday, I got to swear in a big group of CA officers. It was always a very special moment. This one was very unique. Now let me turn to how I intend to work as the Secretary of State if I'm confirmed. Throughout my time in Congress and CIA, I've met hundreds of State Department employees. I know them. And in the past few weeks, I've had to get a chance to meet dozens and dozens more in briefings. To a person, they expressed to me their hope to be empowered in their roles and to have a clear understanding of the president's mission. That'll be my first priority. They've also shared how demoralizing it is to have so many vacancies. And frankly, many of them said not to feel relevant. I'll do my part to end those vacancies. I'll need your help. And I'll work every day to provide dedicated leadership and convey my faith in their work, their professionalism, just as I've done with the workforce at the Central Intelligence Agency. You know, when I took over as a director, I just completed a massive restructuring. Immediately after my arrival, I began speaking at every meeting, every conversation about the agency's mission. We have these, I talked about commander's intent. We do these small things, they're called Meet with Mike. Not a very original name, I will concede, but we gather up the first 50 to come talk to me so that I have a chance to listen to them. I wanted them to know what the President of America's desire was for them, and I wanted them to understand that I was depending on them. And you should know, when the team needed additional resources, I defended them, I asked for them, I demanded them. And the President, so long as he found value, never hesitated to provide them. I was able to persuade him. And with your help, I'll do the same thing at the Department of State. You have my commitment, too, with respect to this. I'll work with each of you to fill the vacancies that are at the State Department. This is critical to strengthening the finest diplomatic corps in the world, and America and the world needs us to be that. Second thing I'd like to highlight is workforces and their culture. I'll spend a lot of time on this. It's important. I'll proceed on, but without getting that part right, if the team doesn't understand the mission and isn't working towards the same goal, it's incredibly difficult to think you would achieve it. I've always done that. When I've traveled as part of the agency, I've met with State Department officials, I met with my own team, I spoke to them about the things that I was going to demand of them, the things I was going to permit them to do, and how I was going to hold them accountable to that task. I remember I went to a location, the housing for officers was simply inadequate. None of you would have allowed your families to be there. I didn't have a lot of time, but I went and spoke with the ambassador and told him it needed to be fixed. I wanted the State Department families and ours to know that we cared about them enough to provide living quarters that were sufficient for Americans. And you should know I believe deeply that the State Department's workforce must be diverse in the same way I've worked for that at the CAA. Diverse in every sense of the word, race, religion, background, and more. I will work to achieve that diversity just as I've done in my current role by focusing on the mission and demanding that every team member, be treated equally with dignity and respect. And I'll listen. I had an old crusty sergeant first class when I was a brand new second lieutenant said, "Lieutenant, if you'll just shut up and listen for a bit, your life will be a whole hell of a lot better." He was right about that. He taught me a heck of a lot, how to be a good platoon leader, I intend to do that with the talented people that reside at the State Department. Let me talk a little bit about the work itself. By definition, the job description of the Secretary of State is to serve as the President's chief foreign affairs advisor. This was driven home to me in those conversations with every former Secretary of State to a person. They were remarkably consistent by saying that job number one is to represent the President. For me, this means building substantial relationships with our allies, relationships that President Trump and I can utilize for both tough conversations and productive cooperation. It also means working with our adversaries where needed to make clear objectives and let them know the means by which we intend to achieve them. In this regard, I'm fortunate to have a sizable head start. On many as a third of the days at the agency, I was engaged with foreign counterparts. I've led the CIA to forge stronger relationships with those partners all across the world, in the Middle East, in Europe, Africa, and Latin America. I've traveled to these regions to demonstrate the commitment that America has to working as their partners. I've also met some folks who didn't share many of our objectives. I've tried to find, and I've asked my team to find those narrow slivers of common ground where we can work together to deliver the results that America needs us to. Representing America also recalls promoting America's ideals, values, and priorities, because they ultimately determine the trajectory of geopolitics, and we need to do that well. You know, I'll close here as I'm approaching the 5 minutes. You should know that I have been an enormous beneficiary in my life of some of the most remarkable diplomatic achievements in American history. I served, as Senator Roberts spoke about, I served on the border between East and West Germany. And I watched diplomats over an extended period of time from both parties achieve an outcome against the Soviet Union and the Communist East that prevented my team from having ever to conduct the battle which we prepared for every day. It was remarkable work from foreign service officers over these many years. I thank them for that. It was the right approach. It was an approach that worked for America. I know some of you've read, the story is, I'm a hawk, I'm a hardliner. Or, you know, I read that and there's no one, as you just heard in what I described, there's no one like someone who served in uniform, who understands the value of diplomacy and the terror and tragedy that is war, like someone who served in uniform. It's the last resort, it must always be so. And I intend to work to achieve the President's policies with diplomacy, rather by sending our young men and women to war. I know that I'm serving a president who feels the same way, and that while the military balance of power, you all did good work to assist us in continuing to build our military to be the finest in the world, it can set the stage and create leverage, but the best outcomes are always won at the diplomatic table. You know, America's diplomatic engagement, political engagement, foreign policy engagement around the world has always been a big topic of debate. I'm sure we'll debate vigorously today. Yet all through my life, I've been reminded that once the debates conclude, the carrying out of foreign policy, the actions that America does make it real. It is a matter of duty to get it right. And while we might agree to disagree today on what or the how of global involvement, we rarely disagree on why. It's to defend the safety of our families, the prosperity of our nation, and the survival of freedom in the world. Diplomacy gives us the chance to achieve these goals peacefully. And I thank you for the time, Senator Corker.
Thank you for the testimony. I'm going to withhold my time and use it for interjections along the way. And with that, I'll turn to our distinguished ranking member, Senator Menendez.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Director, thank you for your testimony. Director, the Washington Post reported last year that on March 22nd of 2017, you and the Director of National Intelligence, Coates, attended a briefing at the White House with officials from several government agencies. The article says, quote, as the briefing was wrapping up, Trump asked everyone to leave the room except for Coates and CIA Director Pompeo. The president then started complaining about the FBI investigation and Comey's handling of him, saying officials familiar with the accounts Coates gave to associates. 2 days earlier, Comey had confirmed in a congressional hearing that the Bureau was probing whether Trump's campaign coordinated with Russia during the 2016 race. After the encounter, Coates discussed the conversation with other officials and decided that intervening with Comey, as Trump had suggested, would be inappropriate, according to officials who spoke on condition of anonymity to discuss sensitive internal matters. That's the end of the quote. So, Director, this account strongly suggests that the President asked you and Director Coates to interfere with then-FBI Director Comey's investigations into the Trump campaign's contacts with Russia. What did President Trump say to you and Director Coates in that meeting?